Good evening, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to yet another episode of Date with DYC. Our guest for today's evening has something in common: her love towards youth ministry and children. We welcome our guest, Alrika de Lima. Come on, everybody, please give her a round of applause. Alrika, I love the outfit that you're wearing. Can you please tell me what exactly is it?
So, honestly, Melroy, this is something that's very special to me. This okay. was a gift that I got whilst I was working at Manipur.
Wait, Manipur?
Yeah.
Now I know why Ivan's invited you. Now this gets a little interesting. Manipur, what happened? Why did you go there?
So, to be honest, I was fed up of studying, okay? I was done with it. 15 years of education and I did not want to do a single minute more.
Okay.
And... Honestly, being part of DYC, being part of Take Charge, I had met so many new people.
What did you do in DYC? Like, how were you associated with DYC? And can you also tell us about Take Charge, what Take Charge is?
So, I started off with Take Charge, which is a mentorship program for Catholic youth.
Okay.
Where I got a fabulous mentor called Fiona Miranda. And I started off with CLAIM just a year after that.
So, guys, CLAIM is Certificate in Leadership Acumen for Youth Ministry. So, this is is a two-year-long program organized by DYC where they give you trainings in leadership, public speaking, writing, how to organize a meeting. So, if you all want to know a lot more about CLAIM and if you all want to be a part of it, I think I should go and approach your youth directors. And they'll be better to tell you about what CLAIM is and how it can benefit you. Coming back to Alrika de Lima and her travel to Manipur. Bolo, bolo, madam, humko bhi janna hai Manipur mein kya hua?
Before, like you spoke about CLAIM. CLAIM is somewhere where I started initially networking.
Okay.
That's something I learned was the biggest and the best you can ever do is networking.
Okay.
I started meeting new people. I started getting to know what others were doing. And that's how I realized, hey, I have an opportunity to go to Manipur. So why not? So 2 weeks after I got done with my graduation, I packed my bags and I flew off to Manipur. The first day in itself was something else. I remember traveling and we had something called a Shaktiman, which is basically a truck. And it got stuck right in front of my vehicle. My first day in Manipur, I was stranded. Absolutely, my destination was up the hill another 2 hours.
Hmm.
But well, I had a fabulous boss. I have a fabulous boss. And he arranged for everything to be settled. But I reached that place at 9 in the night, not really sure what I'm supposed to be doing.
So, how long was your travel? And I also, knowing you, I know you have motion sickness. How did this travel happen?
So, the first night that I traveled was probably... 4 hours, which is so less compared to what I've done.
4 hours?
Yeah, that's the least, Melroy. I've traveled for between 8 to 10 hours to reach some of the most remotest places in Manipur and meet the children there, see the work that's happening to help our organization.
Okay, so while you decided that you need a break and you packed your bags and you flew off the next day to Manipur, what basically was your inspiration?
Honestly,
just taking a break, but how did you... I'm sure there'd be a thought process behind screening whether Manipur or some other place. Like most of the youth now want to go only to Goa.
Mm.
But there's no inspiration. We know what the inspiration to go to Goa is. So what is your inspiration behind going to Manipur?
I started off volunteering from a very young age.
Okay.
And there are so many volunteers in Bombay. Anywhere you go, there are ample number of people who want to come and help out for something.
Okay, in Bombay.
In Bombay, yeah. And when I heard about Manipur, I realized I didn't really know much about the place. And I really wanted to get away from Bombay. I really, really
wanted. So you didn't, what I understand is you didn't like the fast life and you wanted something to slow down. And instead of 100 kilometers per hour, you wanted something like 20 kilometers per hour.
I did not know anything but the fast life. Do you know what exists except the fast life and the vacation in between?
Now I understand. Because of the lockdown, I realized that, okay, Mumbai also can slow down.
People went crazy when the lockdown started.
People went crazy.
But I was like, hey, chill. This is what I've always been doing for the past 1 year. Finally, I get my time.
Okay, tell us more about your experience in Manipur. I believe that electricity and the things that we get here for granted, that's electricity, water, probably meeting people and sleeping at odd hours and having the comfort of probably some, like having a geyser, having hot water, having a heater. What was that living there like?
You said geyser and I can like shed a tear. There's nothing such as a geyser. I've had to bathe with chilling water in the coldest of winters at a well or a pond sometimes, and I was lucky, honestly.
Damn.
But I was lucky because I was a teacher, I was Miss Alrica there, so I would get the privilege of hot water sometimes. But our children have been used to nothing but the coldest of water, the harshest of weather. I have this 2-year-old boy whose name is Vidhingambo. And at the age of 1.5, he already knew how to climb uphill.
Oh.
When our children are not even sure how to crawl, this boy I've seen has fallen down. His nose has started bleeding a bit. Not crying.
Not crying.
He's walking uphill to search his mother.
Okay, yeah. So you spoke about children. What is this children? Like, did you go to Manipur to chill or did you go to tease the children? Like, what did you do in Manipur?
I honestly don't know why I exactly went to Manipur, but I realized that badal important hai. The clouds are what made me just look at, you know, when we say the sky, you know, our teachers made us color the blue, the sky,
sky blue. It's not blue.
I want to say bullshit, but that's not true.
Sky is
the
pink.
The sky is pink, the sky is purple, the sky is any
every
color
other,
you
but
want.
Blue.
It is blue and it's all shades of blue.
Okay.
But what I die and I mean what I live for are the children.
Yeah.
Some of the sweetest, some of the most hardworking, some of the most underprivileged, honestly.
Okay.
Children that are.
So were they only underprivileged children or were they some sort of a home or what is the story about the children?
I spent my time at various different places in Manipur. I spent my time initially at a place where children had to walk 1 hour downhill to their school, 1.5 hour uphill to their school on a daily basis.
Okay.
On the other hand, I actually stayed at a home for HIV infected children.
Oh.
That is something I hold close to.
So tell us more about this home which has HIV infected children.
So anything that I say would be less, you know, in this short time, but I landed up spending 5 months of my time at this home for HIV infected children. I remember when one of the evenings a 5-year-old, I call them my babies, one of my 5-year-old babies fell asleep on my lap, and I remember someone coming and saying that, Miss, don't get them used to it, because you know once you leave there's nobody do that for them. And that's when I told them that I'm here for the next 5 months and I have that time. So every night I would go and give a kiss good night
to
each one of my 5-year-olds, 6-year-olds. I would go and do that to them.
Okay, so tell us more about this home and how many children do live in this home. And
This particular home that I was staying at had 68 children.
Okay.
We also had adults living at that home.
Okay.
But the place I stayed in, called Churchanpur, that place has, I think, one of the highest population of HIV infected people right there.
In India?
I think it should be.
Oh.
So, also, so many of the children, they're like, I'd honestly want to highlight this one story that's so dear to my heart that I always hold it really close to me. It's one of this small 5-year-old boy, let's call him E. So,
Mr. E.
Yeah, Mr. E. So, E is probably 7 years old now and, you know, does not really remember me as much. But he used to call me Miss Avika. So Arika. All of them had an accent, okay? There's an accent from Miss Arika. So we were sitting once in front of the fire and I noticed that his pants were soaking wet and he had come right from having a bath.
Okay.
So I realized that if I had not caught it then, my tiny E would have slept the entire night
with soaking wet
pants with no one to really look at that. So when I took him to his room and his all his belongings are in a tiny box. Each one of their belongings are in a tiny box.
They're very, very organized that way.
Not really organized. All you have are a couple of pair of clothes. Yes. So there's nothing much than that tiny box that you live for.
Okay.
So when I went there and I took out one of his pants and you know as a small boy I'm telling him to keep his hands on my shoulder.
Okay.
So that I can put his pants on for him. My tiny E had no concept of how can he put his pants on if his hands are on me? Because no one had ever done that for him.
Oh.
So I finally was able to tell him that no, E, leave your hand here, and I was able to put his pants on for him.
And that's so emotional, even hearing that story and probably imagining that happening.
The number of things we take for granted, honestly, is that we got as children. Also, another thing I'd like to highlight is communication.
Yeah.
I spoke in actions, tried in words, nothing really worked, but there was a love communication, you know. I would go to my Nu, which is basically mother, and I would tell Nu, I'm very hungry, and that's it. She didn't understand English,
but
she would give the best of food that was there in her house, and she would give it to me. I remember once she wanted to communicate with me and she just could not, and we both just stood there and just smiled at each other knowing that we loved each other so much, and that's it.
So how was traveling? How was it? Was it easy to travel to different places, and did you all have the luxury of a car or a jeep or something like?
I was always hitching rides. I was always so. So, people who know me know that I don't really like to work, okay? I'm somebody from somewhere, I'm okay being there. But when it came to work, I would travel to any lengths that required. One thing also I just remembered is, at one of the locations I stayed at, the doctor closest to my location was approximately 5-6 kilometers away.
Okay.
So when we had a sick child, very few times we would get lucky to get a vehicle. But mostly we would walk. I've walked those 5-6 kilometers. Don't think about me, but think about the child who's unwell. I walked 6 kilometers with a child.
I'm thinking about the child only.
Shut up, Melroy. So I went there.
And the child in you doesn't want to walk. I'm like, Mommy, I don't want to walk.
Exactly. And I'm thinking about that. I was very unwell, by the way, when I was in Manipur as well.
So while coming back, the child was well and she was unwell.
Exactly.
Okay.
How you twist things, Melroy.
Yeah, that's good, right? So you also come across this person who is very actively involved in church and actively involved in the youth ministry, and while in college, and now that you've come back, also you're part of it. Like, how do you manage? And what advice do you want to give people who their parents don't give them space, but have their own room for themselves? You're living with so many children. To people that. You can also give in time to church, and you also have the liberty of learning so much in church. How do you tell people that I think you should volunteer at these places, because these make you, they give you all the experiences, and they also so much of learning that happens.
So honestly, Melroy, what I like to say from my experience, I've been lucky to have parents who have given me the freedom. But what's more important is that it's building that trust. That's so important for youth right now to sort of... dedication, honestly, we're all so much jumping from one thing to another that you need to know that this is what I'd want to do, this is what I'd want to explore. But more than anything, be kind to yourself.
Okay.
If I'm sitting here today, the amount of anxiety that I have when Deacon Ivan first called me up and he said, well, Alrika, why don't you come? I was like, no. You know, there are so many people older than me, younger than me, who've done so much more than me.
Yeah.
They're going to look at me and say that, you know, why does she deserve being here?
Yeah.
They're going to look at me and I'm bothered about, do I look good in this position? Have I become fatter? Have I become thinner? And then I took a breath and I said, I need to be kind, not only to others, but to myself as well.
Okay. So, wait, I want to know, like, how are the churches there and how are the people there and are they Catholics, are they Christians, how's everybody there? Is religion a very core thing there or it's very far more relaxed?
So, while moving through Manipur, we have two things. One are the tribals who are mostly Christian. And then there are the ones who are in the valleys that are mostly Hindu.
Okay.
My organization being secular, we worked with everyone of them. But while exploring, I realized that the Catholic Church there in Manipur is so different from what we know here today.
Oh.
We live by certain rules, Melroy, that absolutely do not apply there. We think that the church is A, B, C, D. But the church is all letters of the alphabet, all colors of the sky. There's something you've never seen.
Like what? Give us an example.
So for instance, honestly, they have no idea that we exist. When they came to know I was Catholic, they said, Miss, Catholics exist in Bombay?
What?
And I was like, there are 17,000 people in my parish in itself. And if you see the way they are spread out, the different tribal cultures that are incorporated into the Catholic church there, it's so different from what we know Catholic church as it is in Bombay.
Okay. So I had the same experience when I went for World Youth Day in Krakow, and we met Catholics from Pakistan and Iraq, and we were awestruck that Catholics do exist in Pakistan and Iraq. We never knew that, but when we met them, they also were very hostile towards us, and we had a conversation. There we end up taking selfies together, so it was a good experience. And I never knew that people in Manipur think that Catholics don't exist. We do exist, guys. We do exist. We are also Catholics. Please, if you all are watching this video, please give us a thumbs up. And if you all like the video, please follow us on Instagram. That is @SALDANHAMELROY. So please follow us on Instagram. Yeah. Okay, so is this a very tough decision for you to come back, or do you wanted to always stay in Manipur?
So, after going to Manipur, I worked with such fabulous people. I realized that the knowledge that I have wasn't enough. I decided I wanted to be a psychologist.
Okay.
And I don't want to be a mediocre psychologist. I want to go back. I want to go back and meet those same children who really need help. Yeah. And so, coming back, so many things fit into place. I'm so glad I took this 1 year off. Because I don't think I would be so dedicated towards pursuing psychology right now, so dedicated towards actually wanting to learn, actually having opened my mind to so many aspects that I probably wouldn't have ever got a chance.
Amazing.
One thing that I'd like to remind everyone who's watching, that it's your own pace. When I heard about taking a year off, I heard it from people who were going abroad. But I did it in India. I didn't go to the Northeast. So it's not now that everybody start running to Manipur, everybody start running to Imphal and go
running
to Manipur.
Running to Ladakh
and Goa.
Not Goa, man. Don't encourage people to go to Goa. I'm just kidding.
You could probably do everything that I'm doing in Bombay in itself. So yeah, choose your own path. Be kind to yourself.
And something that I would also like to tell people, that it's okay to take a break. It's okay to take a break for 1 year, for 2 years. And this is what I think the pandemic has taught us, that it's not always needed to run at the same pace like others are doing. It's okay to
And more than anything, Melroy, it's important to reach out. Like, for instance, for me, I've never selected a certain thing without actually talking to professionals in that aspect.
So you're trying to say that it's okay to take help.
It is required to speak to people in the field. For instance, get in touch with me, get in touch with Melroy. He's such a fabulous host here. Get in touch with him as to what all he has done. You'd probably get to learn so much more.
Yeah, thank you. So to follow me on Instagram, you have to do @SALDANHAMELROY. Just kidding, okay? So yeah, that's what I'm saying. So even we've taken a break from work, we've taken a break from college, and we've seen whether this is what we want to do. Also, try and do things that make you happy in the long run.
Do things that make you happy today.
Yeah, and okay. And also, it's okay if you make a mistake. It's fine. It's okay to make mistakes as well. So just think of how you want to change and make it better. So thank you, Alrika, for giving us such lovely insights about what you're doing. And this is such a fabulous thing that you're doing. I'm sure a lot of people are going to get motivated and think of finally taking a break and chilling for some time and then deciding what they want to do. So we have this tradition that we go and take a selfie in our selfie. So we will go to the selfie booth and come back. So we'll come back to the selfie booth and take. I want to introduce you to somebody special in the selfie booth. Okay, are you ready? And then we go into games. 1, 2, 3. So, Alrika, this is a selfie booth with our guest, with our ever dost, that is Jesus Christ, and your host, that is me, Melroy. So come, let's take a selfie. Smile, cheese. So we are back with our game, Alrika, and this is such a fun and lovely game that we've decided. So it's called Ponga Donga, and we will have to play this. We have lovely juices set up for both of us, and it's a very easy game. So okay. You have to try and put the ball into my cups, and I will try and put the balls in your cup. But what is the easier way to do it? A little difficult. We are gonna play Never Have I Ever also with this. So once you pocket the ball, you have to ask a Never Have I Ever question, and if I do it, then wish I will. The first person to drink three glasses, the opposite person wins. So, I know I'm going to win this. It's okay. Let's see. So, Alrika, are you ready?
Never have I ever been
more ready. No. Oh, nice. Okay, you want to go first? I'll go first.
Go first. Okay,
start. Go for it. You want me to go first?
Yeah.
Okay, let's start. Ponga donga. Oh, okay, and also only one tappi allowed, not two, not you can just throw
direct
the ball.
Direct you can throw.
Direct also, or one tappi.
Okay.
You can't.
Hey! Sorry.
Okay. Say.
Never have I ever spoken ill about a priest.
No, I haven't spoken ill about a priest, but I still drink
liar.
It. Up. I haven't. Maybe like a joke or something like that for sure. No, I will drink it.
Oh, bottoms up. That was literally Mangola.
Where do you get all these terrible juices from?
The budget.
Now three balls, three shots.
20 hours later.
Yeah, three, okay, just, please give me a tissue. Never have I ever said I'm going to for mass and never attended mass.
Never.
Okay, then still drink it. I've never, but you drink it. I'm sure she has, she's lying.
Just a lucky streak.
Never have I ever been judgmental about somebody's sexuality.
Never.
Are you sure?
Literally never.
Okay, theek hai, but phir bhi piyo.
Phir bhi piyo. I'm a fair master.
One more, I have to hit one more, only one more. And then I win the game.
But why am I drinking if never have I ever? How are you winning? You're literally not winning.
But I'm winning because I pot three this na.
This is terrible, yeah.
Finish it! Okay, your chance. Chal! Okay, now that you have had the third, we will not have this never have I ever now because she's clearly losing. Please win. Please drink that. Okay, we'll give you one more chance to pot this.
What, you're not having a never have I ever?
But I'll have the juice for you. Sure.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Hmm.
So thank you, Alrika, for this lovely time that you spent with us at Date with DYC. And we had a lovely conversation with you. And I loved your previous outfit. Okay. So we have a small token of appreciation, and this is a small little gesture from all
of
us.
Thank you so much.
So this is, okay, for your coffee that you'll drink. And this is a big token of appreciation that this is for you. We've trying to reach Coffee with Karan, but our budgets are not the same. So we will eventually reach there, okay? Eventually, okay? Thank you.
Okay.
And so don't forget to like this video, share this video, and subscribe to our channel to know more about DYC activities.
What's the name of the channel?
DYC Mumbai. They know the channel.
Tell me that you need me now. You want to be my friend. that you cannot accept. It is here we must begin to seek the wisdom of the children and the graceful way of flowers in the wind. For the children and the flowers are my sisters and my brothers. Their laughter and their loveliness can clear a cloudy day, like the music of the mountains and the colors of the rainbow. They're a promise of the future and a blessing for today. Though the cities start to crumble and the towers fall around us, the sun is slowly fading and it's colder than the sea. It is written, from the desert to the mountains they shall lead us. By the hand and by the heart they will comfort you and me. In their innocence and trusting they will teach us to be free. For the children and the flowers are my sisters and my brothers. Their laughter and their loveliness can clear a cloudy day. And the song that I am singing is a prayer to non-believers. Come and stand beside us, we can find.
In the next episode.